Thanks very much. It's an absolute delight to be here to talk about a fantastic project in Victoria. I was just back in May of this year that the Treasury handed down his budget and indicated that the East West Link project was the Victorian government's highest priority road project. And since then we've embarked on a very ambitious program of trying to bring this project to a stage where the government can enter into a contract next October. It's quite a massive PPP undertaking. The entire East West Link is 18 kilometres long and runs across the Melbourne CBD, going from the end of the eastern freeway across to CityLink and ultimately right across to the western Ringo. This is a project that is going to respond to the ever-increasing demand for traffic in Melbourne and particularly to service the freight industry. The state government has made it very clear that its highest priority is the eastern section of that, running from the end of the eastern freeway to Holdsworth across the city. And we can't be embarking on procurement of that stage. And concurrent with that, we're doing the planning for the detailed planning for that part of the project and also the adjoining section that runs down before. The authority and the previous government and undertaking the planning for the western part of the project. This government has the eastern end as its highest priority. It is, even the eastern end is quite a massive project, it's somewhere between $6 and $8 million. It's 9.6 kilometres long overall, and that includes twin three-lane tunnels that are 4.4 kilometres long, and they're along underneath Alexander Parade and underneath Alexander Cemetery, of course, and also Royal Park, which is an extensive park development in that area of Melbourne. It has, project has one interchange along its length, and that's about that which provides access to Melbourne Zoo and a very well-used sports facility for the state and the hockey centre. Now, as well as this project, the state government has decided that there will also be complementary works undertaken on the eastern freeway to provide additional traffic lines there to support the project itself. This is similar to what we've done with our other PPP and toll roads. It's going to be delivered and financed as under availability model, and there will be significant contributions by the state government to the capital cost of the project both during construction and at the end of construction and facility development. And the state will be acquiring its own tolling system and will maintain the revenue, the traffic out of the revenues. I think that's probably enough.
Thank you. So privately financed $6 to $8 million, look to sell the revenue streams coming out of a big game.
Correct, with those significant contributions to the capital cost by the state.
Thank you very much.
And we're hoping to release the request for proposal at the end of this
month. Paul, do you want to draw out perhaps some things about the WestConnex program, the differences, the points of difference that are going on between Melbourne and its agency in particular?
Yes, certainly. I've been approached already now for WestConnex for about a year.
It's actually only 23 years old.
Business case with the government earlier this year, and we had announcements on the 19th of September that government, both Commonwealth and state governments, would proceed with the state numbers. So we've got $1.8 billion allocated from the state government, $1.5 billion from the Commonwealth. The whole WestConnex is a 33-kilometre program that works, which has been delivered over 10 years. Stage one, which we're proceeding with now, consists of two packages, two projects. The M4 widening is the cost factor, so we're letting that in the same project. We've already seen the planning application. We've started a sort of industry engagement where we've got a concept design going on, which is later, I'm sure. The rest of WestConnex, as people have realised, is, I suppose, a reference design. So we have a reference design for the other components of WestConnex in a business case. What that means is we define a scope of capital cost. We define a timetable, which is timely principles to have funding and have financing strategy that makes the project viable. But we're open to developing strategies for the rest of WestConnex.
If you can summarise, in effect, you're looking at a reference case that are publicly financed, art delivery model, using off-balance sheet debt, right? That's the reference case.
That's the reference case, yes. But I think it's important to recognise that we're about to establish the Western Delivery Authority. It's an industry briefing on the 31st of October, which will cover three things: the development of that authority, the governance, we'll be looking at referencing some detail. We'll then seek in or starting process industry engagement and seeking innovations from industry, but also proposals from industry. So it's it makes sense on the final construction.
Thank you very much. Right, do you want to run us through all of these and any relative consensus project?
North Australia is all about delivering a fundamentally different rail service into Sydney's rail network to bring a step change in the quality of the service we're going to get operating across the whole control of Sydney, obviously. But for us, the focus is the northern part of Sydney. The 38-kilometre railway, 13 stations to be serviced, running from northwest Sydney around Rouse Hill through employment areas of Norwest and Macquarie Park and into Chatfield, connecting with the rest of the rail network. Fully automated rail systems, that's something new for Australia. Platforms for all the single leg trains, which is something that Sydney doesn't have at the moment, and levels of reliability that we're not accustomed to here in Sydney or Australia, but around the rest of the world. And ultimately driving major sort of economic benefits, growth, shape and way growth occurs in the northwest of Sydney. That's sort of the end picture we've had. We've got a commitment to deliver that by 2019. We've been working very hard over the last two and a half years to scope that project out and get it underway.
Contract types.
Yeah, so there's a total capital value, $8.3 billion. The land acquisition is done, land conversion is largely done. We've got three major contracts to deliver. The tunnel contract, which Bruce Munro's organisation is getting out there this week, actually, establishing on site and getting things underway for construction. So that's a big step forward for us, a 15-kilometre tunnel design and construct. We've got a smaller surface project viaduct and some surface civil engineering at the Western End to deliver, and that's to be awarded target by the end of this year. And then the big part of the project is the PPP, which will come in after that. We will pick up an existing rail line 28 Chatswood, 14 kilometres, and upgrade that, and then we'll take the big civil infrastructure that I've talked about and basically convert and create a new automated rail system, fit out the stations, build transport and changes across the whole region as a BBB with a 15-year operating session on completion. So it's a massive change in the way we have procured projects here in Sydney for rail, and a massive change in the way we're going to deliver rail services as well. In the way we're bringing that together, we're working on the envelope of transport for New South Wales, so that's obviously been an organisation that's been established over the last 2 years. We've got a dedicated delivery office within that organisation with an independent advisory board to oversee and to give the government some assurance around the delivery, but also working closely with transport, who will ultimately be the end manager of the contract and partner with the private sector in that space. So that PPP contract, I've got to say, that's in the tender phase at the moment. There's a few people in the room here that I do recognise have been meeting pretty regularly in recent times. That tender closes at the end of this year, and we're targeting an award second half of next year.
Thank you. Roger, do you want to give us a flavour of what it is you're doing over Queensland and Motorways, and also health and some of those concerns?
Yeah, sure. I should probably start by saying that, as Brendan said, when he introduced me, I'm part of Projects Queensland, but I have some other roles as well. So therefore, anything I say might not necessarily represent the policies of Projects Queensland. Just to make sure that I have access to policy.
Just for clarity, anything difficult or complex, he says, he's saying.
I saw one out there, it's just a car that works and I get to work on Monday. Projects Queensland has essentially become that part of Queensland Treasury which deals with a couple of complex projects and complex procurement, so it compiles business cases and preliminary assessments. It undertakes procurement where there's a sort of a high level of complexity around it. And having said that, it also looks at one of the projects Warren Cross was talking about this morning, was the Toowoomba Second Crossing, working on a business case for that project. There's business cases in progress around the social housing space. And one of the other fairly topical things in Queensland at the moment is the whole subject of contestability. And Project Queensland also is involved in some of those opportunities.
That's involving things like contracting for financial services, how to try and provide this. So really quite different experimentation. What I was trying to do with those initial questions is to give you a flavour that there is quite a bit of experimentation that's going on in the way that different jurisdictions are financing the government programs. You've got Ken with a standby authority, you've got Paul who's establishing a standby authority, you've got Rod who is running it through an internal standby, and then you've got a specialist procurement. So it gives you an idea of the different experimentations going on in government. Given that you're all trying to deliver similar-ish things, you're all trying to deliver built infrastructure, how often have you talked to compare the way that you're going?
Quite often, we've had a very good conversation with providers.
Yep.
Conversations are very frequent, very open, and stolen a few good ideas from Ken.
Yep. And what's the forum that comes together to help you do that? Is it just?
For me, it's been mainly informal. Yep. The good thing about that is you can have some very open conversations. People have been willing to share good experiences with bad experiences.
Ken?
Yeah, Brendan, there's been a very close relationship over the last 10 years between Victoria and Queensland, particularly with respect to the large PPP ramp projects. That's mainly came about through a couple of us knowing each other pretty well and speaking in forums and developing that relationship. And I think in our former organisation, when we did the deal on this link, Dave Stewart, who was working with the Brisbane City Council at the time, told him we'd had a very successful outcome and would he like to hear about it, and he subsequently said that it would be fantastic. So we went up there and spoke to him and his council and his staff, and decided to adopt largely our model for the Tennessee project, and that subsequently continued on with the airport thinking government. But as Paul said, we've been engaging with him a fair bit. Not only coming down to see us, but it's us coming to see him as well, and also some of his treasury colleagues. And Rod's been down to see us. I think this informal relationship is very good. We're trying to all together to develop our skills so that we match the skills and capabilities in the private sector, because they have one PPP project in one state to another state, so they're always enhancing their skills, and it's attractive that we.
So if you've got a national government that's been elected, wants to do stuff, wants to change IA, wants to harness best practice, all these sorts of things, is there a mechanism that we need to think about, given that we are looking at a big outlook for similar projects, difficult times, all of the rest, is there a role for federal government to start pulling some of these things together outside of the personal relationships that you have with the small infrastructure community?
My personal view is that federal government and state government is too involved, becomes overpowered by the bureaucracy, and personally the informal relationships that we have. We all work within bureaucracies, from responsible to the department and to minister, town bodies, and we have a lot of dialogue in Victoria with the Department of Treasury and Finance, and hand in glove. It has to be that way with the domestic practice. So we do all work very closely together, but I think this informal arrangement of sharing knowledge and experiences is a very good one. Personally, that's the way I feel about it, but I don't know what my colleagues
think. Well, the rest of the panel, I think there are better opportunities to perhaps harness this in more than an ad hoc sort of way.
I think Jan Paul there is a lot of conversation going on. We've been out in Victoria, we've been in Queensland, where producing is coming our way a little bit at the moment, because we've been going for a while, so we're excited to be sharing the other way as well, which is good. But there probably is a, without overdoing it in terms of frameworks, an opportunity to put a bit more structure and a regularity around that, just to make sure that something is happening. I think that there's a strategic leadership rather than getting out and putting too much mechanics into a room. There are times where you get caught up in a project and you do tend to forget, so just to get that regular reminder. And in a place that, you know, someone that actually maybe has a picture of what's going on across all the projects would be something. But I want to share some canned reservation that you turn into a lot of real process in the market. And so that's the executed really well.
And Roger, what do you think are the opportunities to have sequence to release the projects to learn from some of these variants that you're doing around public health, whether they're in or out of the infrastructures and other things, or lessons the other guys are learning on each of their MOA rather than projects?
Questions there, Brendan. So if we talk about the lessons learned thing, I think that's really important. I'm a bit with Ken on this, and that if we try and control it centrally, it just becomes another process. We're all bureaucrats delivering projects, and the bureaucrats love process. The process becomes a means of ticking another box. If we spoke to somebody else, or we tick that, so we get a box to order. But I think we probably do need to have some more structure around how lessons learned to share. And what we'll also find, I think, is that from at various times, one state or another state is probably ahead in some of the work that they're doing at the moment, where we are around some of the contestability opportunities. I think we're probably ahead of everybody else. And we need a means of sharing that with everybody so that there's a common understanding of where we're at. And this is not something new. I remember probably 3 years ago looking at how we deliver a better infrastructure or better value infrastructure. That was a theme that kept playing out there. So. And then finally, sequencing. To my mind, getting best value out of infrastructure really depends on getting a decent sequencing system in place.
So you wouldn't buy 4-7 light rail projects all at the same time in different places around the country?
Yeah, probably try not. All that does is drive up costs, takes away resources. So I think we do it reasonably well, but I don't know that, again, there's a satisfactory structure to make sure that works consistently across the project nationally.
So what do you guys want out of infrastructure in Australia, out of federal government? What is it that would be useful, not bureaucratic?
During the WestConnex business case, we've had good engagement with the federal agencies. I think some continuation of that improved dialogue, so they understand what we're trying to achieve.
So when you went to talk to the federal bureaucrat, did they speak the same language?
It took some time to get on the same page with what the project was. But through that,
so the appointment of a dedicated funding, financing, project advancing type function within infrastructure Australia, which is one of the commitments the government's made, is going to give it a more useful practical edge, I think, is that one you can talk to?
I think so. It's about getting better when we're talking rather than looking at forms and saying.
Yeah, I think probably that point that actually helped build a better network. You do tend to find stumble across the network as you work your way through it, and there's opportunities for people to do all that and just sort of constructively point in the right direction. There's something happening over here that others are kind of knowing about, well, there's something to do. And so a little bit more strategic outside.
And what's the average of what the government should try to do in projects over here? Things like equity, things like federal procurement, putting them down in state agencies. Where does the efficiency get lost? Where does it become more of a confusion?
Mine's quite straightforward, and I'm going to the source state fund, so I don't have to worry too much about that. I think there is a real dilemma there about obviously the Commonwealth putting money in, so that one has some insane influence, but there's a real risk about in doing that that they don't quite get what the state's trying to do with the project and actually delay or confuse for quite some time. So
that? One of the things that's quite different about this period of procurement compared to the last decade or so is that frameworks are being adjusted in the way we haven't seen. Probably since 2000 when Victoria brought out its partnerships with Victoria, frameworks probably when we saw the evolution of procurement really stop, and it's really been the drive of more limited funding capacity that's started to drive some. How do you incentivise the public sector to be able to put forward these different options, to take risks on procurements, and when you're doing things like contracting clinical health, either within a capital structure like you're doing in New South Wales or outside like you're doing in Queensland, or if you're trying public finance delivery models and taking a degree of risk of that? How do you sort of entrench that into the approach of procuring agents and bodies, etc.?
Project was the responsibility of the Department of Transport at the time, and we were doing all the background work for that, and we have some key advisors working for us, such as PwC and Clayton Hicks, and on the engineering side we have GHC that we used other people to help us work for that business case. And the fundamental aspect of that, we could get the engineering group level right, but we had to make sure the financial structure was going to be right as well. Now, with all of our traffic analysis, we know that this project is not going to be one of the successful as a target until we entire project. It's such a costly project, it's probably around 12 to 15 million dollars. And naturally, in a project of that scale, it's typically a false project, it has to be delivered in stages. So it's not until we get all three stages linked together and we're operating that we come to a target. And that's why it's appropriate to start that. At this stage to hold the traffic and revenues. And so that's a fundamental recommendation of the business case to the start government. Treasury also played a very key role in the development of the business case, so we should have been funded right in writing out the new masters.
I think procurement methodology involves initially big projects. These are quite different to the type of how you incentivise public sector, I think it's about looking at lessons learned in all jurisdictions, also overseas, and looking at the risks around particular projects. I suppose it's the worst. We think it's going to go to the
next. What makes you as a public sector project director wake up and think, we need something different? You're going to try something, put them up.
I think with these major projects, we have to do something different every time because there's a fixed range over time, so changing the locations.
I think it's easy to look at, I'll do the business as usual approach. What you've got to do is try and go down the path of the outside of that as well. They're often together, you can save. I'll keep doing more of the same. Yeah. The save's over, I understand that. But there is a new downside trying to do that in project environment, so you've really got to weigh that up against actually the opportunity we'll have a crack at doing that. Certainly, the Northwest, I think, that obviously the process of the industry, they really helped influence, give us some confidence around some of the directions and decisions we wanted to take. We had enough feedback to industry around 5 years, so when we were talking to the government about that, it wasn't just changing the bureaucracy,
south part of the
Do you think, based on the experience you've seen in Queensland and New South Wales and Victoria, perhaps less so, do you think that some of the independent prioritisation type functions you've seen out of construction in New South Wales, out of Queensland, occupation of water and the construction of Queensland crisis, do you think that's led to better approval of the projects? We read for a while in this paper about a fairly vigorous contest about different options we did in the project project. Do you think it's led to better policy making, better employment? What do you think it's led to?
I think it's led to better prioritisation. You know, WestConnex is sort of long time trying to do things like quarries and duplication. The standalone project is, I think, a different approach.
And skills is probably the last area we were what I wanted to really ask is how are the skills issues affecting resilience so far projects? Do we have the ability for endless project directors to come back with this issue resilience? We've got a lot of single projects coming through. How are we going to manage the ability to define the project without the market as well?
That's a very significant task. We can't be too worried about what's going on in the other states. Not that we're in competition, but we work for a government and they've got an agenda and we've got to try to deliver on that agenda. And so I have a strong view that we create the opportunities for the private sector. If we can get that opportunity there, then it's up to them to respond. So I think when we went to the marketplace with our EOI invitation in late July, we'd given the private sector about 6 weeks' notice that we were coming forward with this EOI, and the response was fantastic. We're absolutely delighted, and we've shortlisted three, and we know those organisations are so positive, and it's up to them to make the decision of whether they're going to participate in the opportunity. I don't have a worry about the skills and resources that I have in private sector in this moment.
talk about skills. I think one of the key things about getting a deep skills base is a consistent pipeline of projects. Consistent pipeline of projects allows organisations to build their skills and capacity with confidence and the knowledge that those skills will be utilised going forward. And I think the biggest risk to the skills base that we have is a pipeline which is inconsistent and which balloons and then shrinks and balloons and shrinks. Every time it shrinks, organisations have to decide whether they retain staff. If they don't get low staff, I'll get them to stay overseas or go do other things like a rotation job. And it's really hard to get them to come back. So a consistent pipeline really works to benefit of everybody, government and private sector.
You made a point regarding competition with other states. Within New South Wales, we probably are seeing a direct competition with transport agencies for the skills to do the very large projects that you and our colleagues are delivering. Are you confident that you're going to have the skill that's there for these projects that follow? The public sector side, the private sector is obviously responding actively, but there is a lot that's coming into the market. How are you dealing with it in terms of authority, in terms of the law?
I'd say we're not where we will need to be with project like Northwest. Certainly, as we move from what's been a fairly substantial 2 or 3 years of planning and procurement into delivering, we've got a significant shift in the type of skills we need, and a lot of work going on. This stage is to draw in those new skills, albeit a lot of the work will be done in the way of our contractors. We've got to retain the direct skill on our side. We're trying to there is a degree of agreement, but you know, when I look ahead and on Northwest, we've got a pretty big job over the next 2 to 3 years to get ourselves in the right place to manage it for every task.
Paul, you're going to pay us on the role of the task.
Well, we're following in his wake, I suppose. So, when we set up WestConnex, the federal authority here, there is going to be an expansion of the project to do, to get some of the private sector. But I think they will look into some broad strategies. There are some people maybe who have had that experience in the early stages that we can probably get out to.
And just in close, I might ask you to imagine that you're doing so. What is it you want to see most as the agency is reformed? What is it you want to see most to make our job different?
Yeah, I'd probably like to see Infrastructure Australia part of the role of overall coordinator that kind of encourages collaboration, encourages sharing of skills and sharing of experiences. And also like to see
I think the point we made about just a bit of better collaboration across projects in terms of West and South Africa as well, and that's another one is to help us, particularly at a project level, understand where the industry is at, what the pressures are around the industry, so when we're making decisions at the project level, we've actually got a better context of what's actually happening. We can maybe make some changes in the way we're looking at things. So, better knowledge about the interface between government or between the projects and the industry would be really helpful.
I think picking up on those two comments, a better two-way dialogue, especially for Australia has a more thorough, more better understanding of the projects and which one to do the projects.
I think they should accept that state governments pretty well versed and knowledgeable about prioritising their own projects. Just to come along and give us a basket of money.
Very good. Well, look, ladies and gentlemen, that brings us to the conclusion of this morning's programme. We've been very patient as we've moved through an excellent series of presentations. I would like to ask you, first of all, to join me in thanking these gentlemen for sharing their thoughts. About what is a massive delivery program, and I'd like to invite you to move immediately through the room next door. We'll be moving straight into the final session, which is lunch. I will be addressed by the Panelists' Managing Director of Maritime. Please take anything.